Would you please be seated? It's my privilege to welcome you all on behalf of the family for this celebration of the life of Catherine Mary Prowse Nee Fuller. We recognise that some of you have covered large distances in order to be present here today, and we thank you for your efforts, and it's good to see you. There are people here who went to school with Cathy in Grafton. There are people here who were a part of congregations in which we served. There are many relatives, and we are quite a family, both the Prowson and the Fuller side, and are in constant contact with each other, and it's good to be here. We are honoured at the presence of the moderator of the Uniting Church in New South Wales and ACT, the Reverend Marta Javier Hilal, and we thank you, Marta, for coming and for making time in a busy schedule that you must have, and for other ministers and colleagues and people we have worked with together, we thank you for being present on this occasion. The West Epping Uniting Church has played an important role in our life together as a married couple. We first moved here in January 1965, after we were married in the previous month, and the Methodist Church posted us in various placements following that, starting in 1970. And we returned again to this church in 1991 when I was Presbytery Minister of the Parramatta Nepean Presbytery. And then again, after a break, we came here in retirement in 2015. And now, for the benefit of those who are in my age bracket, the toilets are at the bottom of the stairs on this side, just at the back of the church. And also, if you want a more level approach, go through the hall and out to the toilets that are on the other side there. At the conclusion of this service, Cathy will be piped out of the church and placed in the hearse. The hearse will then move slowly to the corner, after which you and all invited to join us in some light refreshments in the hall. We have chosen, and we talked about this, we have chosen that nobody will go to the cremation. After Cath has been cremated, and in several weeks, her ashes will go to the historic Castlereagh Uniting Church site, and there will be a niche there in the wall, and I have one reserved for future days, some time, I hope. So thanks again for coming. This service has been the responsibility of our daughter, the Reverend Melinda Graham, and she'll now take us through the service as we bring this celebration to you and we share in it together.
To say thank you to the Reverend Otto, who is the minister here in this church. Otto is a good family friend of ours. Otto and I met in college and had some interesting times there and some fun times. And Bella and the family are good friends of ours. And he has been very generous to my family, and I want to say thank you, Otto. Thank you very much. Also wanted to say thanks to Reverend Radhika, who we're stepping will know as well, and she's going to play the piano at the blessing later. Thank you for doing that. And recognise the Synod Associate Secretary, Reverend Bronwyn Murphy, is here as well. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Friends, we have come together, gathered here today because you loved Catherine Mary Prowse. And she was our friend and our family, a loving daughter, a faithful wife, a devoted mother, and a beloved grandmum, sister and aunt. Cathy was our sister in Christ. And here we will mourn her leaving us, celebrate and honour her life and death, reverently farewelling her body, and we come together to comfort each other. We have come believing that all human life is valuable, and the truth and integrity and hopefulness which resides in each life lives on in the kingdom of God. We come believing our Christian conviction that Cathy's life, for which we mourn today and for which we now experience great loss and grief, release and peace, is not the end, but makes for a new beginning in a relationship with our God beyond death. Cathy's life was lived in its uniqueness with us and has now passed into that ultimate community of human existence with God. And today, we, although maybe sad, we are going to celebrate her life, because that's what she'd want, right? She'd want us to celebrate her life. And the two can exist at one time, I've discovered. The gifts and graces which she offered us are never lost to us. She was a great friend, a mother figure, hospitable, an encourager. She was loving, loyal, truthful, forgiving, strong, selfless, caring, generous, intelligent. She was a teacher. She was involved. She was supportive, an organizer, reliable, and a very hard worker, clever with her hands, and had a green thumb. And she loved to laugh, which I hope we'll do later because my brothers are talking. She was a traveler, a great hockey player, an artist, and an adventurer. All this she shared with us in her life and relationships, which now lives on in our lives and travels with us on into our future. And our lives are so much more, so enriched, because we have lived knowing Cathy Prowse. Jesus said to his the sister of a dear friend that had died, "I am the resurrection and the life, and those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." Let us pray. Strong, loving God, at this moment, as we come face to face with death and our own mortality, we are unsure of what the future will be like without Cathy. Please come close to us with your love and travel with us into this serious moment and open our hearts to each other. And please, God, give us the courage and the strength for today and grant us your peace. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to now ask you to stand and sing a family favourite hymn, "O Love That Will Not Let Me Go." Please stand as you are able.
Thank you.
now going to ask the brothers three if they might come and give the eulogy. Oh, I didn't know that was going to rhyme. I'm sorry about that.
One of the most remarkable talents about Mum was a boundless generosity. She had a heart that was always open to helping others. Whether it was through a warm meal, a comforting embrace, or a listening ear, her selflessness knew no bounds, and she always put the needs of others before her. Our Mum had a remarkable zest for life. She found joy in the simplest things, from tending to her garden or sharing laughter with loved ones. Her positivity outlook on life was infectious, and she was unique ability to find the beauty in every situation.
Thanks, Jason. Now to give you a guide of Mum's life and where she travelled and lived and how she embraced everybody. And then Daphne's going to talk more about her childhood and the family. So Catherine Mary Prowse was born on the 20th of March 1940, and as many of you know, uniquely, she passed away on the same day in Grafton, New South Wales, to Gwendoline and Alan Fuller. Mum was the fourth in line of six girls: Hazel, Helen, Janice, Catherine, Margaret, and Daphne. Mum described her early childhood as very happy and her sisters as central to her life. Many mornings before school, Mum would have to milk the cows, collect the eggs from the chicken pens. Mum attended both primary and high school in Grafton. It was here she discovered her love of hockey, playing in the A team for her final 3 years of high school and captaining in her final year. She also served as a prefect in her final year at high school. Throughout her childhood, her parents were a constant source of love and support to all their daughters. When you mention the word Grafton, my head straight away goes to Christmases in Grafton and all the family. And as you can imagine, there's a lot of us, and we'd pile into these houses. And, you know, seeing the size of us now, it was amazing that all six of the Prowses slept in one room together. And then it was shifts to get food. And with six sisters, it was noisy, but it was fun. It was just absolutely brilliant. We all always look forward to Grafton, our spiritual home. After leaving school, Mum followed her older sister Janice into teaching college at Armidale. Graduating in 1958, her first appointment was the Maryland School for Girls. Mum then went on to teach at North Strathfield, Beecroft, Petersham and Glenorie Public Schools in a career spanning 40 years. Throughout these years, she had special interest areas including such as sport, choirs, dance, children at risk and children welfare, gender equality, environmental education and the creative arts. She received many awards for her environmental work. Mum never attended teacher strikes, preferring instead to make sure any children left at school were cared for. In 1959, Mum met the love of her life, a handsome young youth leader named Vernon Prowse. He asked her if he could walk her home from the dance. I love that. And so the adventure began. On December the 19th, 1964, they were married at Concord Wesley Church, where a lot of the people here today resonated from. All their wedding party are here today. Daphne, Janita, Kevin and Lloyd, very special. They built their first home at 123 Murray Farm Road, Beecroft in 1965. And my understanding it was £10,000, which is extraordinary when you think of where we're at now. And the house still stands as it was. It was there that they welcomed their first child, Martin, standing here with me. And Mum always loved that Martin had a sense of the adventure, and his name was Martin, but he went by a lot of different names throughout our lives. And he was just reminiscing outside of all the different names that he called himself. And Mum loved that. She always got a giggle from that. Then in 1970, Dad was called to ministry at Casino Methodist Church in New South Wales. It is here where their number two son was born, Cameron. And I too had a few names, and one of Mum's favourite, when we were young, she'd ask me my name, and I was a bit obsessed with the $6 million man, and I'd answer, Cameron Allen Prowse, big boy strong, Steve Austin. A short time later, they moved to a ministry position at Nelson Bay and then on to Armidale Methodist Church. While in Armidale, Mum and Dad were surprised to find out they were expecting twins, but equally delighted at the arrival of Melinda and Jason. Again, Jason took up many names in his life, and most people here would probably call him by the name of Booker. It's on my phone. That's how I've known him for a long time, mainly because he wanted to become a policeman and book his older brothers. But Melinda, not so much, but brothers being brothers, we have given her a few names. I won't repeat, but one might end with Dibbly. Mum's love language was acts of service. She was always so generous with her family time in serving the greater community. Dad tells the story while living in Armidale, there were members of the local Indigenous community would come and ask for food, never daring to come to the front door, too scared of our dog, choosing a yell from the street. She was so generous that one time, Dad recalls he came home and we had no food. She'd given it all away. The family's next move was a big one, all the way to Putnam, Ontario in Canada. Shortly after arriving, one of the biggest snowstorms in the history of Ontario hit, leaving us stranded inside for nearly 2 weeks. The locals came to get Dad, and they all went out on snowmobiles to the local highway to rescue all the people stranded. And Mum recounted Dad didn't arrive back home until 1 a.m. He'd been out so long. But the following day, the neighbour's son made mention of the fact that he'd never get on a snowmobile with Dad again. Way too scary. Our years in Canada were very cherished by Mum. Long life friends were established, and we received many phone calls and condolences and messages from there. Mum had a wonderful sense of intuition, and one time, while we were swimming at Woodstock YMCA, she safely packed us all in the car and rushed us away to home. And only moments later, a tornado tore through the city. We returned to Australia after 4 and a bit wonderful years, the trip home highlighted by a great adventure through America and Hawaii. The next chapter of our life unfolding in Lynfield, Sydney.
Thanks, Cam. I'm due from when we came back from Canada and arrived back in Lynfield in Sydney. It's an honour to speak here, and thinking about, you know, you'd only do your mum's eulogy once, so you better make it okay. But in the end, I just want everyone to know how much I loved her and I miss her. And there's a lot of tears. I've been crying a lot, but they're not bad tears, which is really, maybe sometimes I should feel more grief, but I'm truly happy for the love and the life she shared with me. And Mum was the same. I don't know many people, when you met her for the last 4 years, she'd start crying when she saw you and say sorry. And I'd say, why are you saying sorry? This is the most beautiful. You recognise me. You're crying because you love me. So don't be sorry. So sometimes tears just mean joy, just expressed a different way. I'm also happy because in my image, thinking about where Mum is now, this is the image I have. So some will be very relevant, some won't. But she's sitting in Auntie Jan's old beach house in that living room with four other sisters and Nana. I guess I should say Fadi too, but I don't remember Fadi. But that's the image I have, them sitting. I assume they're doing some kind of craft, probably asking Cathy how Daphne's going as well, but just having a little chat like they used to between them all. So that's my happy memory, and it makes me feel better, even though I just cry all the time. Cam talked about the time in Canada. It really was a magical time for Mum. If you can't imagine, it was kind of four little towns of less than 200 people that all had their own church, and the church was a central thing to everyone, and she loved it. And I put a post on Facebook, and the Canadian comments, now you've got to think, this is 40-something years ago. I just got a couple that they commented. She was a force of nature, giving of herself to support, encourage, and inspire others through example. Not telling them, example. A beacon of strength, a beautiful smile, a wonderful woman. So this is all from people she was with 40-odd years ago. The other image I want to have is probably not one of my favourite movies. It's The Man from Snowy River. But it's got a nice scene, and I think it represents... I think it represents my mum. There's a scene towards the end, if you can imagine. They're all on their horses, and they're chasing the Brumby pack, and they get to kind of a slight cliff and everything, and the hero of the thing, the man from Snowy River, everyone else stops to have a committee meeting and talk about what they should do, and it's too dangerous, and he goes straight over the top. And that was my mum. She wasn't waiting around for a committee meeting to do anything like that. There's also another famous story from Canada. It's in regional Canada where I think Dad and Mum are waiting at a train station, and she decides to weed the whole train station. Now, you could see a lot of us going, well, the government should do this, or you know, the train station should do this, but this is my mum. It's got to be done, and I'm here, and I've got time. I'll do it now. And that's what she did. And that's why I said when people said she inspired them through example, I think that's what she did. She didn't really tell people what to do. When we got to Linfield, during the next 9 years of ministry at Linfield Uniting Church, Mum threw herself into the leadership of women's groups and Sunday school. It was a busy time caring for her four kids who were all at school. She resumed teaching again, as well as typing all Dad's university papers. She supported our swimming pursuits, cared for Dad's parents, as well as her own mum, who came to live with us for a short time. During this period, she also helped care for her brother-in-law, Eric, when he was undergoing his cancer treatment in Sydney. She opened a home to friends and family whenever she could. My mate Eddie was basically there constantly. I don't know if there were many days when he wasn't at our house. Also, Mum, for a couple of years, gave me a lift to school, and we just pick up Eddie on the way to school every day. It was a different street, but it was just, you know, my mum looking after all my friends. The next move after that was to Carlingford, where we had the great fortune of living next door to some great friends in the Cadmans. I think that Runnymede Way, it was just a lovely cul-de-sac with a great group of community, obviously connected to West Epping as well. We began attending West Epping Uniting Church, where Mum led the women's groups, empowering them to take on the world. She taught then at Glenorie Public School, where she ran the environmental programs. Life was full for her at home, as well as making school lunches and every dinner, typing all Marty's uni assignments. Now, I've got a question here. She didn't type all my uni assignments, but with my thesis at the end, she at Uncle Jeff and Auntie Daphne's house, she knew my weaknesses, patience, and she, I don't know if you can remember, she was there for days on end, just redoing the grammar, redoing the structure, and you know, and she got me through where I probably would have just given up and taken a pass or a pass conceded. And I appreciate that. And she was also at the same time caring for Dad's parents as well. During this time, she welcomed two beautiful daughters-in-law, Shailene and Sancha, who she truly cherished. But she also liked to remind them of how much she cared for her boys as well. So earlier during their ministry, Mum had become a lay preacher at the Uniting Church and led many youth groups. Together, Mum and Dad led a work party of 44 people to Kupang in West Timor, building vital infrastructure for their local community. Over the years, they were involved in quite a few migrant community groups, especially with the Tongan and Korean communities. Upon retirement, Mum made a considerable contribution to the greater community through her volunteer work. She realised her time volunteering at the 2000 Olympics. One highlight was when she pushed through the security to greet the Prime Minister, John Howard. Mum said, "Hi, John." To her surprise, he remembered her and said, "Great seeing you, Kath. How's Vern doing?" Mum and Dad knew John and his wife through their daughter, because Melinda and Melanie went to school together. So there was a connection. One thing I'd like to say to that, I tell this story quite a lot of times about how my mum basically shirt-fronted the Prime Minister at the Olympics. That's funny and stuff, but it's what she said. She said, "It's Cathy Prowse," and that's what I remember. My mum knew who she was. It's Cathy, like I say, it didn't matter if it was a Prime Minister or a young kid at school. She was Cathy Prowse. She said, "John Howard, it's Cathy Prowse. You'll know me. How are you?" And that's what I remember. She knew, and gosh, I wish we all knew ourselves like that. You know, it's probably what I struggle with every day. But my mum knew who she was, and she led by example. Perhaps one of Mum's greatest accomplishments was her 15 years volunteering work with the New South Wales Police Missing Persons Unit. She received an award for her work and the service to this department following the tragic Bali bombings. Receiving the award from Dr. Marie Bashir, who was the Governor of New South Wales at the time, at a distinguished event at Government House. Mum and Dad had immense love of travel. They drove the family the length of breadth of Canada, towing a camper van. So we went from, if you know where Ontario is in the middle, we went all the way to the east, basically Prince Edward Island once, with Grandma and Pa, and we did the other way, all the way basically to Vancouver in a little caravan, where Mum and Dad had to get on one side and the four of us had to get on the other side of the trailer in case it tipped over. So it was quite dodgy for a long time. One trip saw us piling 10 people into Dad's car, also known as the Yank Tank. Hands up if you were in that car. Imagine that. That's one car. There's two seats, okay? There's one car, there's two seats. Now, all of you take your right shoe and sock off and hold it in the air. That's a personal joke for those in the car, so I still don't know how we did that, but we did it. And I never felt like, it was one of the trips of the lifetime. The first day we set up, it was snowing and everything. And I think, you know, with Mum and Daphne there together and enjoying everyone and Emma and Megan, it was just beautiful. Mum and Dad's passports were very full. The many countries they visited included Bali, New Zealand, Fiji, Hong Kong, China, Egypt, USA and Hawaii, the United Kingdom, Russia, Scandinavia, South Africa, France, Greece, Italy, Spain, and Portugal. The favourite trip was to Churchill, Manitoba in Canada to see the polar bears in the wild. And Mum loved her polar bears. I don't know why. She chose it as her spirit animal. I said outside, what if there was a purple polar bear? She'd go nuts. Or lilac polar bear, lavender polar bear. She'd go nuts. But that was her animal, you know, and she wanted that polar bear picture wherever she went. She just loved it. Dad felt a bit jealous, so he picked the silverback gorilla as his spirit animal. So, but I don't think Mum let him put that picture up. So, my parents, in doing all those travels, provided me with really unique experiences that I loved and I've taken with my family ever since. So that's a true blessing that they put all their effort and resources in showing us the world and showing us what you could do. Throughout their married life, Mum and Dad lived in 15 homes. More recently,
Marty's outdone that well.
Oh yeah, Dad'll give me 10 grand if I stay in the one place for 10 years. So, and it's very safe. The most we got was 4, so that was hard. Anyway, they lived in 15 homes. More recently, at Abbotsford, before retiring to Newport. It was during these years that she welcomed 2 more important members to the family, her son-in-law, John, and her daughter-in-law, Katie, to the family with open arms. At this time, her grandchildren were front and centre of her life. Mum was always willing and able to educate, love and care for them, especially with ice cream, and then probably topping on the ice cream too. After the sadness of losing Katie, Mum was overjoyed when the wonderful Julie came into Jason's life, and we are all truly grateful. We love you so much, Julie. As Mum's health began to deteriorate, they decided to move from Newport to Cheltenham. This was sidelined by some poor building developing, leaving them stranded, like the Skipper and Marianne from Gilligan's Island. Lucky for them, Ferg and Daff came to the rescue. It was initially supposed to be 3 weeks. Pretty close to 2 years, I think. So thank you for that. After Mum's diagnosis with pulmonary fibrosis and dementia, life became hard for such an independent and capable woman. She faced significant challenges, but her face always lit up and greeted by family and friends. Family was everything to her. Dealing with dementia is really tough. It's awful. It's just so sad. And it's also, if you go back to the image of my mum being the man from Snowy River on a horse charging forward, it's very hard for that person to then sit back and accept care from other people when she did everything. She was not only strong, but she was smart. And she did things to help us and to help her. She wrote her own memoir, or she basically wrote two. She wrote two memoirs, so if we were thinking we don't have, she wrote the whole life and everyone and all her family and friends within it. She also wrote it for herself because, in my opinion, it wasn't the last 4 years she knew what was happening. So she wasn't just strong, she was smart. She wrote the history of her life. She loved her sisters so much that she detailed everything. And if you saw her in later years, she'd bring out that book and just go through it and through it again. She also had, if those knew it, her little black book. She wrote down everything, everyone's birthday, everything, and she'd just go back and read it. And even when her memory went, she could still go back. So she prepared herself, even though we didn't know what was coming. I think she did. The last thing is, she was extremely funny too. In the last few months at Bowden Bray, she quite smartly got herself upgraded from the shared room to the single room by telling everyone else in the room what she thought of them. And they had to move her out and she got the penthouse suite. So, and she knew that and she recalled the story to us. She knew exactly what she was telling to them. Not that my mum's language was that harsh. I think the harsher she gets, she was trying to bring the word blast back into our swearing vocabulary. And every now and then there was a dang, but that was about it. So, although at Bronte and Liam's wedding 2 years ago, she was sitting there next to us and, you know, she couldn't remember new people. So she's going, who's that man up there? It's Liam. Bronte's marrying Liam. I just want to brush his hair. That's all I want to do today. Liam's got nice hair today, so. And the other funny one, which I tell, which is Cameron's told me this story, on the way to the wedding, because Mum, the short-term memory goes, Cameron's sitting next to Mum on the plane in the middle of the flight, so they've all got on together, they're all going to get off together. She looks at Cam and goes, Cammy, where'd you come from? I think to be funny, you've got to be smart too sometimes. So there's wit, smart, humour and strength underlying. Mum, you'll always be in our hearts. We'll keep your memory alive and we will love you forever. Thanks, guys.
I was just hoping to say a few personal things. No, that's all right. This is Mum's... Yeah, this is Mum's book. And this wasn't possible without Ferg and Daphne. And it's certainly a cherished piece of literature for our family. In reading it again recently, something that struck me was her notes on her life. And she mentioned that her favourite class she ever taught was the very first at Maryland's Girls in a year six class. And I thought that was extraordinary, because I would have imagined your first effort would have been a real struggle, but not for Mum. She loved it, and she noted that she just wished she could have known what happened to all those girls and all their lives. That would have been special. And I'm thinking about that, to me, with Mum, that meant she cared. She cared so much. And when I like to talk about Mum, I talk about her legacy. And her legacy was that thousands upon thousands of people across the world got to share her love and her care, because she wanted you to know you were important, and she wanted you to know you mattered. And for Mum, she was encouraging you to be the best person you could be. And with that, her hope and desire for all of us was that we could go out into our worlds and make a difference like she did. So, love you, Mum. Thank you.
Now, Auntie Daphne's going to come up and say a few words.
I'm just going to ask those who are standing up the back. You see, Prowses can talk forever. So there are some beautiful, comfortable seats up here. Some people are already here. Come and sit down. You're going to need to. Yeah.
My lovely sister, Catherine Mary. Cathy and I were lucky to grow up in a kind, loving family. Six girls made our Fuller family unique. We were a good-looking family, but Cathy's white hair made her a standout beauty. Dad especially showed us off on every occasion he could by asking us to all stand together. Mum would call us all my lovely girls, and this became the title of a family history book Cathy wrote, detailing the lives of our parents and the lives of all six girls, their spouses and descendants. Cathy also produced another book titled Grandmother and Grandfather Fuller. Cathy's research for this book was extensive. Whilst doing the research, Cathy reconnected us with many cousins with whom we had lost contact. Some of them are watching this live streaming of this service today. Growing up, Cathy and all of us led a carefree, healthy country life on our small holding on the edge of Grafton. We had a free rein to ride our bikes all over Grafton and the surrounding countryside. Mum and Dad grew all our vegetables and fruit. We always had two milking cows and many chooks, supplying eggs and eventually meat. Cathy and Hazel were the two who helped milk the cows. Years later, Cathy and I were at the Royal Easter Show at the Dairy Cow Pavilion, where milking cows, both by hand and machine, was being demonstrated. Cathy was a shoo-in when the audience was asked if anyone would like to try to milk by hand. She had not lost the knack. Dad was a great athlete, both in cycling and foot racing. Cathy was the best athlete of his children. She was awarded two blues in high school for her prowess as a hockey player. She was voted in as a school prefect at Grafton High School. And Lexi, one of Cathy's friends, school friends, is here with us today. After school, Cathy went to Armidale Teachers College. Many country children followed this career path, as a teacher's scholarship paid for tuition, all living expenses, and pocket money as well. Cathy had a long and rewarding career as a primary school teacher. Some highlights I remember of her school teaching days are that she won on two separate occasions a Department of Education award for her work in environmental studies. The first was at Petersham Public School and the second at Glenorie Public School. She mentioned these activities in her book, All Our Lovely Girls, but being Cathy, always modest, she did not mention the awards. When Cathy retired from teaching, she became a volunteer in policing. She mainly entered and collated data into the police computer network, much of which was related to missing persons. She worked long hours during the aftermath of the Bali bombing incident. When driving police cars on out and about duties, sadly, she was not allowed to use the siren. Ferg and I enjoyed many travelling holidays with Cathy and Vernon. Ferg, Emma, Megan and I will always treasure the good times we shared with Cathy and with all the numerous members of the extended Fuller family over many years, and look forward to keeping in touch with all of them in future. Thank you, Cathy, for being a lovely sister. And from all your Fuller nieces and nephews, thank you for being a lovely aunt. Goodbye, Catherine Mary. A life well lived. I came about when I glanced over there, I shouldn't have.
Thanks, Aunty Daffy. Beautiful words. I'm now going to ask the grandchildren, they're going to talk briefly, and they're coming in, can I get you to come in order of birth, is that all right? Yeah. So Martin Prowse's, Cameron Prowse's, and then the Grahams. But you can all come out the front and stand with each other, and when you're finished, please be seated. Thank you, grandchildren.
Family and friends, my name is Bella and I'm joined by my siblings Bronte, Nora and Lily. We have come together to share some memories of our grandmum. Grandmum always had such a soothing and nurturing presence. When we stayed with Grandmum and Pop in Sydney, she did the nightly ritual of tucking us in at night with so much love and care. She wove intricate tales filled with twists and turns that gently lulled us to sleep. Although I can't recall the details now, I do remember how she smelt of lavender, felt soft to hug, and her fingers were so light as she stroked my face to sleep. I will always cherish feeling the love and security staying at Grandmum and Pop's house. Grandmum was strong-willed and determined, whether it was organising generations of Prowses for her ancestry book, making flower girl dresses for Auntie Mel's wedding, or taming my brother's unruly curls into a side part, she would get it done and it would look good. She stood tall and exuded a quiet strength that commanded respect. I've always admired that about her, and it's something I strive to emulate in my own life. To stand tall, to be proud, and to live authentically, just as she did. We will think of you, Grandmum, every time we see a brooch. She loved a brooch and big clip-on earrings. It just tied the outfit together. Grandmum, you'll be dearly missed, but your love will live on forever.
Thanks, Bella. Ashton and I feel so incredibly blessed to have shared so many wonderful memories together with Grandmum. So today, in honour of her life, we'd like to share a few with all of you. We had a very adventurous grandma. She would take us everywhere as kids. Together, we would travel by ferry into the city and visit the aquarium, Manly and Taronga Zoo. We went on so many fun adventures, so much so that we started a little collection of books together. My top two favourite stories we published were Sienna Goes to the Zoo and Ashton's story, Dad Goes to the Beach. They're honestly really great reads. There's even about the author section at the back of each book, which obviously we did not write, which I just thought was hilarious reading back as a 23-year-old realising not much has changed. We also had countless adventures at Newport Beach together, where we really tested her patience as we'd refused to get out of the water because we were having too much fun. Some of our favourite memories were growing up at Newport. I remember staying over and sleeping in the study, and Ashton and I would pretend to be asleep and then jump between the beds and then quickly pretend to be asleep again before Grandmom came in because she heard our not-so-subtle, "Shh, she's coming." Grandmom also opened our eyes to the world of English murder mysteries, like Rosemary and Thyme, at the ripe age of 10. The BBC's Planet Earth documentaries, which I think has like led us to really want to adventure and love of animals and all of that. And she really introduced us to ice cream because, yeah, she really loved that.
They say the hardest part of life is finding someone you can't live without and then living without them. But I don't think we'll ever live without Grandmum. I feel that in the past week I may have cried more than ever, or maybe laughed harder than ever. I might have even got a little bit smarter, but I just think these are just little parts of Grandmum passing on to me. So next time you notice that you're smiling a little harder than ever before, just remember that smile that you shared with Grandmum. Till we meet again, we love you.
Thank you. Grandmum was the boss of my mum. She always had a key to our houses, always came early to mum's parties. My mum would talk to Grandmum all the time about everything for ages. We learnt to talk on the phone with our grandparents, and she always asked good questions. Mum would do whatever Grandmum asked, even if her mum said, "Don't touch the ironing, just relax." She would say, "I can do what I want to." She gave us Christmas presents like makeup and Barbies when Mum told her not to, and she would accept it. So Grandmum was the boss. We have the greatest respect for her. She was thoughtful, stubborn, smart, compassionate, generous, kind, and she loved us. Mum and us holidayed with Grandmum and Pop most holidays. We loved her making us special breakfast of crushed up Weet-Bix, homemade yogurt, and banana. We loved baking with her crumble top apple, the little mini apple pies, Anzac biscuits, muffins, and whatever creative things she had come up in her head with. For the morning teas at our church. Art time with Grandmum was expressive and also precise. Remember to colour in between the lines, she would always say. We remember she came to everything she was allowed to at school. Mum would always get there early to save seats with a good view to please Grandmum. Grandmum loved reading to us and encouraged us to write stories. This is something Georgia and I are really good at now. Going to playgrounds, trips to the beach pools, sand castles. Pop would always say, "You only have 30 minutes till we go," and Grandma would trick him into a longer time so we had more fun. She loved flowers, trees, birds, feeding kookaburras on our balcony, pointing out blue wrens and the like. Grandma and Banjo Thunder had many cuddles. He was our dog. And a special connection. If he wouldn't come inside when Mum called, she would always say, "Grandma and Papa here," and he would come racing in to see. Grandmum loved our dad too, always having a good joke. Dad respected her a lot and felt loved by her. Grandmum was always trying to help Dad and told him he could give up smoking by having a drink of water. Dad never thought this would work, but Grandmum was always right, Dad. Trips to the zoo or the Alpha House for music and other excursions meant taking buses and ferries, which was fun for us, particularly because on the ferry there was like an ice cream stand and Grandma didn't have to be asked twice. We remember our Christmas times. Grandma loved Christmas like Mum does. She and Pop would come to our church and house, or they'd be waiting for us to arrive after Mum's services at someone else's house. Grandmum was always there to save the day if someone got injured. My clear picture of Grandmum in my head is dancing with her at her beautiful 80th birthday party just before lockdown. Grandmum loved God, and we have been set a good example on how to be faithful women in this world. Thank you, Grandmum, for everything.
I know that there are many out there who would have liked to have been asked to speak, but you can see my family talks, so we're not going to do that. So make sure you stay afterwards. We'd love to hear your stories. We're now going to hear from the Bible, our Holy Scripture.
The first reading is from Psalm 121. A song of ascents. I will lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The following reading is from Romans 8. Nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God. I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. We know that everything God works for the good with those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. He did not also give us all things with him. Who shall bring us any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who dies. Yes, who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, who intercedes for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, or anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love in God or Christ or our Jesus or Lord. Thanks be to God who gives mercy, us the victory. Thanks be to God. This is the word of our Lord.
So my mum asked me to take her service, and so I do what my mum tells me to. And she also said, you make sure you preach. Don't cut any corners. Okay. We are all relieved that Cathy is released from the pain that she was in and the dementia and the confusion and the humiliation that Alzheimer's gives people. Very relieved. But we are also deeply in loss because she was our family and friend. Because she was a light in this world for many. Psalm 121 is part of a group of psalms, and they were the road trip songs for God's people on a pilgrimage. This psalm provides words of assurance that if the faithful fix their eyes squarely on the source of their help, then the Lord, the makers of heaven and earth, the maker who does not slumber, will indeed guard, keep watch over and protect, be your shade. So the faithful are to set their sights on God for the journey
where God is in front, at the centre, and where God is our destination. Mum loved this psalm. It was a strong affirmation that the God who created all of it, and even us, will be the one who generously provides help, whether the road is easy or tough. God is there, whether you have dementia or not. God is there. Our help comes from the Lord. Mum believed that to be true. This is good and reassuring news, that we don't have to go it alone. Such a perspective reminds us that we believe in a God who is all-powerful and all-knowing and all-encompassing God, who will not abandon ship at first sign of trouble. In fact, we worship a God who will stare at the dangers we face with us and will not be moved and will not go to sleep. A God who is able and willing and ready to help. The challenge, though, I think, for us actually, is to let God be our helper. While the remainder of God's power and might are definitely inspiring, it is also tough to embrace. And if we're honest about it, we don't relinquish control easily. Instead, we tried to find our own ways. And the Bible is full of stories of God's people trying to find their own way, and falling over each other and suffering. Humans refusing help even when it's readily offered through many dangers. It isn't always easy to ask for help. Sometimes we only have the courage to do it quietly or in subtle ways. Today, this psalm asks us to consider letting some of our own tightly held things go, so that we might have room for God and be part of a bigger picture of our journey and to see the bigger picture around us. One of Jesus' followers in the New Testament, Paul, describes God as a God of all comfort in all affliction. I don't know if you've heard the saying that God will only give you what you can handle, but I don't think this is biblical. I think it's an impression that we've carried on in the church. But Paul says that God will be our comfort, not sometimes, not most times, all the time. But what words are going to help us today? Maybe those words Jesus said to Mary and Martha when Lazarus died. I am the resurrection and the life, and those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Do you trust this? You get to say today, God, God Almighty, catch me in the midst of grief and pain. In the second Bible passage, it says, the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that is about to be revealed. Grief takes people down really dark roads, and sometimes it's just more than you can handle. And Paul himself talks about that in the time when he was working in Asia. He talked about his time as so utterly burdened beyond their strength that they despaired of life itself. So it sounds to me that Paul had more than he could handle in his life. But then Paul goes on to say, his learning at this difficult time was that in the knowledge is that beyond himself, God is there and can be relied on. To rely on God when we can't do it ourselves. We rely on God who will raise Cathy into a new relationship with God, a new awareness, a new reality. And we trust this until our faith is in sight and we experience it. And all knowing when the kingdom of God is then our home. Our grief and pain is not forever. Others believe that after death there is nothing, an abyss, there is no God. That creation is a fluke and a convenient magic chaos that set this world going. So as Christians, this is what my mum wanted to say. We believe that's a lie. And that there is much more to this story. And all that is created. And much more to the story than the church holds as well. Psychologists say you need to accept the death of Cathy. Well, how do we do that? How does Dad accept that his life partner, knowing her more than 60 years, has died? How do we? How do we accept somebody who loved us even before we were born, is now dead? She was our family's hero. A very steady strength. We are separated from Cathy, but not from her in the eternal life. So it is just for a while. Death has no sting. Cathy believed this to be the truth, and Cathy never lied. We were brought up in the Prowse house to face the truth, however it was, whatever cost it was to ourselves, our pride, we were taught not to lie. There are many pursuits in our life's landscapes that would be considered successful. But only some eternal things remain. And these things are faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is. And they are the anchors of our soul in this storm and this time of grief. One of the ways that God will bring beauty out of tragedy is that he enables, equips us to bring comfort as Christ did in this world. And so we comfort others. And in serving others, we heal ourselves. God wants us to reach out in a spirit of generosity to touch people's lives selflessly and love those people who are unlovable and bring others to know a generous, loving God. The world can be a hostile place, not only to what followers of Jesus believe, but be generous in this life anyway. Reach beyond yourselves and touch others so that with generosity of spirit, we transform the stubborn and the ruthless. Cathy was courageous in her life. She made a choice to be an intelligent, strong, creative, brave, and generous woman in her life on this earth. Everybody seemed to be her family. Even my in-laws were her family. And that's the same for everyone here. She always wanted to be in on it all because she helped people belong. She was incredibly generous, holding gatherings to extended family or retired ministers and their spouses or ministers in placement or for students or for our friends. She opened our house to swimmers from all over the world, for Canadian friends and friends of friends. She looked after relatives visiting from the country, medical appointments or hospital stays. Mum fed so many people, gave her time to others, made dresses and sewed for important garments, for weddings and for formals. She did so much for others, and there's too much to mention. We are celebrating that life of giving, of generosity. We are celebrating Cathy. She chose, out of her own heart, to maintain a quenchless hopefulness in her faith, in the midst of all circumstances and trials around her. She lived being a strength for others. She lived God's gift of humility in cheerful strength, her consciousness a testimony to her choice to generously give what she could, to care for others, and to be a happy and kind person. And just like Auntie Daffy said, today we celebrate and honour a life lived well, a life that chooses hope over fear, community and caring for others over individualism and selfish gain. She chose purpose and caring for others over apathy and despair. And every one of you are given a choice in how your character will grow in this life. We are not all given the same choices, but as we mature, we grow to understand the responsibility of who we are as people. And when we reach the time to pass on into the next world, we will discover the truth as to whether or not what we have valued here on earth has eternal value or not. Sounds a little scary? Not really, because God loves. God is on our side. God undertook a courageous plan to take away the fear of horrible death, our fear of the horrible sting, the valley of death. We were terrified, and God steps in and solves the problem, solves the law of justice, and replaces it with grace. Not karma, not an eye for an eye, but generous grace. And the demands of our sin, our mistakes, are poured onto Jesus Christ on the cross. It is Christ who conquers the death. So, what do we have to fear if God is for us? Will affliction or disease or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword define us? Will dementia define us? No. In all these things, we are more than victors through God who loves us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor power nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Awesome is our God, compelling and compassionate. Christians are besotted, God's besotted people. Our connection to God and creation is felt deeply, and we show honour to God. God's purpose is here on this earth by loving God and loving our neighbour. Cathy witnessed her strength in a generous love for all of you. And so now I'm going to ask the grandchildren if they might pass out to all of you. Mum's scent was lavender. And tidying up Mum's things, we found lavender bags everywhere. So we've made for you lavender bags today. And the grandchildren are going to swiftly move through the congregation. And if you would like one, please take it. If you don't want it, that's okay. I hear some people are allergic. You don't have to take it if you want to. And that is the way generosity works. Freely given, but it's also up to you to receive. I'm going to continue. Cathy witnessed her strength in a generous love for all of you, and it was strong, and it was a humble example, so that others may know how to be happy too. Perhaps you saw Christ's heart in Cathy. Humble in nature, strong in her own identity, compassionate for those in need, courage in the face of obstacles, patient and resilient in life struggles, openness to her neighbour's need, and joy in abundance. Let her life speak to you of an enduring spirit of strength. Let her life inspire your curiosity to choose a faithful, happy life, a generous and kindly life, to carry forward that precious gift of quenchless hopefulness. And we who believe in a transforming God will transform our circumstances and defy our challenges of the heart, mind, and soul. This is a time of Easter. Don't forget the choir stalls. And we remember God's love for us was so strong, so personalized and customized, that it bore the weight of the world on that cross. So it is with Jesus, and so it is with us. The good news is this. God is that stronghold that will never fail. The steadfast friend who is always there to help. The one we can trust with even our biggest failures. And know that in the end, God will still love us. God is always there. Hands outstretched, heart wide open and ready to help. This is a generous gift of grace. This gift of love, it's a gift of help, ready for us to accept. God calls for you, and wholeness is not a myth. God is love, and love cannot stand aloof or apart. God helps us to let go of the physical things we cannot hold on to and opens our heart to the eternal things which we will never lose. Hear the call to love your neighbour as yourself, and let it be said of you that you were so generous in this world, showing love for your neighbour, that it too was strong and personal and customised as far as you were able. Amen. I'm just thinking that you might need to stand for a bit. Would you like to all just stand, and we'll get the next part ready? So if you want to stand, you know, what do they call it? Nummus bummus or something? Yeah. Squiggle about. Okay, please be seated again. We're now going to have a reflection in photographs, and my beautiful sister-in-law is going to sing.
Lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. Of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything.
That song reminds me of Mum. Just want to say that Mum lived to a ripe age of 84, and that meant so much change in this world if you think about it. So much change, and she was a part of it, and so much change for women. In Canada, there was patchworking, the quilting. And I was little, very little, and the women would talk around the patchwork. And Mum introduced the idea that these women had their own name. their own Christian name, that she was not Mrs. Vernon Prowse. She was Mrs. Cathy Prowse. Well, I remember it sort of ruptured the talk, and maybe it wasn't accepted straight away. But the change happened. She introduced change for women in all sorts of places. She was not afraid of the church, and the scripture stood beside her. And she wasn't afraid to be a part of the change and not just accept it. You will notice that the songs through this service are progressively getting more modern, because Mum was also not afraid of the church that is coming and the changes that are needing to be made. Well, we're going to pray a prayer of thanksgiving for Mum. Let us pray. Lord, we give thanks for the life of Catherine Mary Prowse. Cathy was a behind-the-scenes person and a leader. She was reliable. Her character was rock solid. She was so patient with us, Lord. Hard-working, organized person. Her thoroughness and dependability would see projects through, and some weren't even her own projects. They were others, enabling success for so many people she helped and occasions she enabled, and for that we give thanks. We give thanks for her practical, matter-of-fact, realistic, responsible manner, deciding what work needed to be done and working steadily towards it, regardless of distractions. Cathy always coped. She was always willing, and everything looked like it was no trouble for her. We give thanks that Cathy was a loyal person, loyal to her family and her good friends, and loyal to her church and community. We give thanks for her many friendships. She would never want us to view her as perfect, but we now give thanks that she was respected throughout her life and respectful of others. Cathy delighted in the world around her and loved her country, loved animals and flowers and trees and waterways and beaches, loved sport and music and dancing and feeding others and empowering women and taking photos. Oh, so many photos. And gardening. Always found Mum gardening. She never sat still for long, and in her presence, we weren't allowed to either. Volunteering in her community, working hard in kitchens, becoming a lay preacher, seeking adventures, teaching the emerging generations, this world loved Cathy. And Cathy loved creating something from nothing. For all these acts of skill and generosity and kindness and thoughtfulness for practical solutions for others, we give thanks. We give thanks for the family she was born into and all the love she shared with her family growing up, and her love for each family member of her extended family, no matter what was going on, was rock solid. She thought the world of you. And we give thanks for the holidays spent together and the occasions we celebrated together. We give thanks for her brilliant mind and her teaching abilities and all the many students over the many years, and for all the dedication and all the care and attention and hard work that requires of our teachers. We give thanks. We give thanks that Dad asked to walk her home, for the marriage she shared and created with Vernon, and for the family that followed, Martin, Cameron, and the boys, and the twins, Melinda and Jason. And the arrival of each of her children into her family was for her a blessing for her life. She was a maternal warrior. she could self-sacrifice and hold her integrity at the same time. She was so involved and proud of her children's accomplishments, big or small. Each of her children had a very special relationship with her. For all the lifts getting somewhere or turning up to our matches in the sporting arenas, for the washing and the cleaning and the ironing and the cooking and the handmade clothes and the typing and the unconditional love, the forgiving. Thanks, Mum. I think you're the best. Her integrity in life made her a wonderful role model. And again, for her children's partners and the grandchildren. She cherished them all, wanting to be an active part in their lives. We give thanks for the family she made, protected, nourished, and prayed for. And we give thanks for the family she married into and the time shared. Cathy's love for each of her family members was strong and deep. Very proud of her grandchildren. She held her faith, hope, and love for each one of them. She has given her husband, her children, and grandchildren an inner strength through her commitment to love them their whole lives. We give thanks for the sacrifices she made for Dad and the family. Lord, we give thanks for her life, good in nature, helpful with no fuss, please. And Mum was not vain. Cathy loved a good book, a murder mystery on the telly, children's stories. She loved to laugh, loved the family table time and the storytelling. And today, Lord, many of us have our own stories of how Cathy was there for them. We give thanks. All her skills and gift are very much appreciated in all the churches. And you, Lord, were the center of all of it. And we give thanks and admire her faith, her strong sense of self in her family, her capable hands, her caramel pies, yum, her pastoral care, her prayers for others, her generous soul. So we give thanks for her ability to bring a difference in so many people's lives humbly. Today we lift our hearts in celebration and gratitude for the life of Cathy, now gone from among us, and for all that she was to those who loved her, and for everything in her life that reflects your glory, Lord, your goodness and love. We say thank you very much. So in strength and weakness, in achievement and in failure, in the brightness of joy and the darkness of despair, we remember Cathy is one of us, and our hearts go with you, Mum. Your heart will be with us. All these things and more you have given to us, Cathy. We respect your journey through life with all of its realities, and we pray that you travel safely into this next part of the journey. And we are happy that you are no longer in pain or confused or restricted, and you are with our great and almighty God to rest and be released. Thanks be to God for the gifts we have received from Cathy. Thanks be to God for a life lived with love and strength and courage and honesty and grace and determination, practicality and useful approaches to problems, her skills, her cooking, her art, her craft abilities, her intelligence, providing a good home life, a family life, her kindness, her thoughtfulness, her generosity. Our love goes with you. God's peace be yours, Cathy. Amen. Please say the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial
and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please stand as you are able and sing one of Mum's favourite church songs, Shine, Jesus, Shine. To a time of commending my mum. As we come to this moment of farewell, part of our grief may be regret for things done or left undone, words said or never said, or moments that never happened. This is the time to lay aside all those regrets and to honour the spirit of Cathy. Cathy herself would not want regrets carried into the future. So let us receive that gift of generosity from Cathy Mary Prowse and the forgiveness of God. To love someone is to risk the pain of parting. Not to love is never to have lived. The grief we now experience is the honouring of our love for Cathy. We respect Cathy's journey through life with all of its realities and pray that she moves safely into the next journey. And the God who stands with us at that moment is the same God who was prepared to die in love for all humankind, a God who has entered every struggle of our life with us and who deeply understands the choices we have made, the fun we have had, the passions we have shared, and all that guides our heart and head. Please stand as you're able. Eternal God, by the creative power you gave us, new life in Christ, rejoicing in your gift of eternal life and confident of the love you have for all, we commend Catherine Mary Prowse into your merciful keeping. Amen. We have entrusted Catherine Mary Prowse into the hands of God, and now we commit her body to the earth, which is welcoming to us at a time of our death. Ashes to ashes and dust to dust, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through the Lord Jesus Christ, who died, was buried, and rose again for us. To God be the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to sing a blessing to you. You might like to join in with us.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Rejoicing, he is for you,
is for you, he is for you, he is for you.
Thank you. stop.